magic is one of those hobbies that makes you a real critical thinker. There is no real thing as multitasking. But a magician happened to actually do multitasking because at any point in time, they are able to do three or four things in parallel.
Welcome to Prime Venture Partners Podcast, a podcast for entrepreneurs looking to build and grow their startups. Learn about uncommon strategies and common traps from makers and doers of startup ecosystem.
Welcome to the Prime Venture Partners Podcast. Today, I'm delighted to have with us Nakul Shenoy, a mind reader, a mystery entertainer, a UX design engineer, and a dear friend who also hangs out a lot on Twitter. Welcome to the show, Nakul.
Thank you, Amit. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much.
Nakul, you know, you recently did a show for us at Prime Ventures and all of our founders, and it was obviously very, very entertaining, very mysterious, and very wondrous. I had a quote that one of my colleagues, Vineet, said at the end of the show. It goes something like, "I shouldn't have a scientific mindset in magic shows. Everything is too easy to crack." This was his thought before the show started. And as it ended, he said, "Science is a lie. They all fooled us for all these years." What do you think about the relationship between science and magic?
Science and magic are very deeply intertwined. Magicians have always been one of the people who have taken the most newest advances in science, applied it to theatrical performance, and made it completely mystifying, not just for their audiences, but also for the scientists themselves. So yeah, they're absolutely, totally entwined. One of the primary stories that comes to mind is Robert Houdin, who actually is known as the father of magic, modern magic, performing an effect using electromagnets in the Middle East conflict, when electromagnets are just about coming out, and trying to show this whole thing of my magic better, my magic more powerful than your magic kind of a thing. Gets into theology, gets into religion a bit there. But and we continue to do that. As you saw, a lot of what I did had connections to modern science and drew from there.
So clearly, Nakul, when you're doing magic, you're not obviously violating science principles. So something else is going on to generate that mystery. What is going on there?
The way I like to look at it is magicians or any performers, we essentially take one science and use it to break another. For example, in a classic magic effect, you may see a magician float somebody in the air. Now that is breaking the laws of gravity. But the way we are going to achieve that is by perhaps using other laws of physics, be it laws of refraction or optical illusions and things like that. Since I deal with the power of the mind and my shows are more about mystery entertainment and mind reading, what I did was turn certain philosophies or concepts of psychology and use it on your wonderful gathering, because I thought that would interest them, because this is a very intelligent audience. And what I intended was exactly what your guest said, which is, can I take them down a path where they think, oh, this is all so simple, but then pull the carpet from under their feet so much that the only explanation that it was all a miracle.
So, I have lots of questions on this, maybe one more and then we'll move on, which is, you know, where is the kind of boundary line, you know, stop between magic and hypnosis and the occult and just, you know, sheer sleight of the hand, right? Is this all like a blurry line, or, you know, in your own parlance, are there like segmentations of this thing?
So it depends on what kind of a performer you are. Since I am a mentalist, I would be using skill sets from across the genre. So as you know, I have been a hypnotist. I learned hypnosis very young. So I use concepts of hypnosis in what I do, perhaps not as hypnosis itself, but as suggestion and persuasion methods. We use a lot of behavioral economic things in terms of that whole thing of when would you take a particular decision? What particular word or action from my side might impact that and how may make you change that decision and so lead you down a path? And again, where we play on the mystery continuum as such, in terms of being a trickster to a magician, to a mentalist, to a psychic, to perhaps a godman and beyond, a messiah perhaps, is completely based on the person that's playing that character. Sadly, as we get along in magic and along magic, I think one of the greatest losses is that we go away from the aspect of, believing in real magic. And some of us like to leave our audiences with that feeling that there is something called real magic. At least leave them with a sense of wonder and not want to find an explanation. Because the moment you find the explanation to how something is done, that's where you lose the whole magic element of it. And all that remains is the method or the trick. And that is not exciting to anybody, not to the performer and not to the audience.
Yeah, even somebody as celebrated and well-known as Neil Armstrong has this beautiful quote that you had shared with me. Mystery creates wonder, and wonder is the basis of man's desire to understand. So you definitely left a lot of us wondering and yet not wanting to chase the wonder too much, right? So I think that's interesting. Switching gears, Nakul, if we were to apply this to real life, a lot of our listeners are startup entrepreneurs, founders, perhaps even working in larger companies. You know, what are the ways in which you can apply some of the lessons from here? I'm not necessarily saying do a card trick at work, which you can apply to various things. Obviously, we're going to talk about design because that's your other love. But, you know, maybe I'm thinking in a negotiation, it might be useful. Maybe it could be useful in a persuasion. Maybe it could be useful in presentation. So if you can elaborate a bit on application of this into a business context or a startup context.
Yes. So one, of course, I would always recommend people try their hand at magic, because magic is one of those hobbies, classic magic even, that makes you a real critical thinker. We have learned recently with science that there's no real thing as multitasking, right? We do partial tasking or parallel tasking in a sense and not really a multitask. But a magician, as a recent book called Neuroscience of Magic has proven, happen to actually do multitasking, because at any point in time, they are able to do three or four things in parallel. I mean, not stopping one and taking on another task, because the mind, the body, and the tongue in that sense, and the eyes, have to be doing four different things many of the times. What the audience sees, what the magician does, and what the magician is saying, and what the magician is actually thinking at that point in time are very, very, very different. And so rather than do a theory session on that, I would highly recommend Neuroscience of Magic. In other sense, there's also this whole element of applying a lot of traits of a magician to the different things that you do. Like you rightly said, some of the skill sets we learn in terms of audience management, in terms of keeping people's attention directed somewhere. The word used is misdirection, but what it really means is that we control the direction of an audience, of a spectator, of an individual or hundreds of people at a time, to very specific actions of ours, which are either what we want you to see or actually always what we want you to see, because what we don't want you to see, you never see. So that's, I think, the masterclass in terms of how can we own other people's perceptions completely in terms of either what they saw or what they think they saw. So yes, so in that sense, I would highly recommend people actually pick up, even learn a couple of tricks. And as you know, my book itself is a good start, The Smart Course in Magic. But either way, it's a fantastic thing to just pick up that skill.
Have you seen examples in the real world, right, of people who are not classically magicians or mind readers applying it? So, you know, Scott Adams, the creator of Dilbert, often talks about, of course, Dilbert itself, but even somebody such as Donald Trump being somebody who uses hypnosis, mass hypnosis, magic, that it's not, he's not as trivial as he looks in terms of his shenanigans, right? He's actually doing something intentionally and hence succeeding in terms of getting political capital.
Yes, I actually read that book. That was a very interesting take. And I agree in terms of a lot of leaders, not just Trump, right? A lot of leaders actually go through training, which has its root in either neuro-linguistic programming or hypnosis. Actually, they may not learn these things as those disciplines, but essentially what they end up doing is get training or an understanding of how can I influence people. And again, Cialdini's book, Influence, is where it all started, right? And his newest one, The Persuasion, is fascinating. Because again, that's essentially what it is. It starts off with what a magician or a mind reader perhaps do, which is at different levels of controlling people's perceptions. But then if we can bring it into what is known as conversational hypnosis or even conversational persuasion, there is a lot of things that happen completely just with your body language, with the way you are able to communicate something. More important than all that, Amit, I see the need for everybody to read our books and learn from books on body language, like an Alan Pease book on Definitive Guide to Body Language, simply because body language is not behavioral, you know, it is biological. We are born with these traits of either influencing others or reading what others are thinking or wanting to do just with minute body language and what's better known as micro expressions. And so the thing is, why do I call it biological? Again, not me, these are from the books. But why it's called biological is a small baby that just born is perhaps the best exponent of body language than any of us can ever get. You know, as we get along life, we forget what we are born with and we sort of lose track of it. And then we have to again go back to the books and sort of try to learn it again. But essentially, look at the way a mother is able to just look at a baby and know what the baby wants, or in that sense, what a baby knows by just looking at you to make you do certain things. Even very young children are able to do that. And so, yes, so there's a lot of things that we can learn from here. And these few books you and I both mentioned are excellent starting points. But the real thing is in the real world. Essentially, since a lot of our viewers here are people who deal with a lot of people, you are always interacting with people. So there is these aspects of instant rapport, small things you can do from books like Switch and things like that, that essentially mean that, okay, just by, you know, it's just weird. I have had to experience this and then try it in my events and in my one-on-one interactions to know that it really works. One of the things I learned way back, what I learned hypnosis almost 25 years back. And one of the things I learned is how just by modulating my own breathing and my speed of speech, I can influence the person in front of me. And that's fascinating, because the first time I heard it, I was like, what? This is nonsense. And then you try it, because that time I was still in college and, you know, in class, you just look at this person sitting in front and you sort of match your breath. And then you just sort of take a breath and just hold halfway. And you suddenly see this person, you know, be uncomfortable in conversations. You speed up your talk or slow it down to match what is the speed of the person in front of you, the tone and tenor of the speech by the person in front of you. Of course, not going to the level of being a mimic. And you see that it completely influences them and you see a pleasant change. I know you have a lot more questions. I'll stop.
So no, lots of gems in there. Of course, I love Cialdini's book, Influence and Persuasion. I think Chip and Dan Heath's book, Switch, all these things are very useful. So it's very interesting that you as a mind reader and a magician are raving about these books, much as we do as communicators or business folks or even product managers and designers, which we'll come to in a second. So let's, you know, like you said, a lot of our listeners are potentially startup entrepreneurs, and they're selling all the time, right? They're presenting all the time. They're selling customers, they're selling employees, they're also selling people like us, venture capitalists too, for raising funding. So maybe can you share one or two practical tips that they could potentially apply just so that they can connect with the concept? I'm not expecting a course in a nanosecond here, but just something that's saying, hey, if you're presenting, notice this. Like the breathing was an amazing one that you said, and I've seen great orators do that, but maybe just another tip that would be useful.
You forget my essential background is that I am a communication person, right? So I do connect a lot to all these books and the learnings in that. It's very difficult to give one or two tips, but let me try. One of the things we forget, and even as magicians, you know, when I learned magic way back, I learned one of the first tricks was how to cut a rope and join it back. And one of the things that took me years to realize is that when I took a rope and I cut it and I tied it together, my eyes and my attention and my body, everything was focused on one thing, the rope and the scissor in my hands, which meant I was knowingly or unknowingly focusing the entire audience's attention on my hands. It took a lot of years to get over that and be able to do it, not looking at my hands, but look at the audience and continue talking and make them look where I wanted to make them look. And that, for me, would be the primary thing to give as a suggestion. We forget the most primary things when we are communicating: eye contact. Just maintaining eye contact with our listeners. And if it's a larger group, giving everybody an equal amount of eye contact and not just sticking to one pleasant face or one favorable face in the audience and alienating everybody is the primary thing we should focus on. Because knowingly or unknowingly, like I said, we don't need to have read a body language book. This is biological. So people will catch on to the fact that, oh, this person is not connecting to me. And so that will put a lot of things on the back foot. And you know as well as everybody else, one no right at the start is equivalent to 10 yeses, in terms of if you start off an interview with a no in somebody's mind, and this is mostly in somebody's mind without you even knowing it. It takes 10 favorable things for it to even come back to ground zero. I know I'm taking a lot of time here. And the second thing I want to add, the most important thing, even more than the eye contact, if I may, is a smile, a genuine smile. Nothing works better than that. A genuine smile that shows how passionate you are about the topic at hand, how passionate and close to heart that is, helps you sell something more than anything else. And so, yeah, we forget to smile. And in a world where we are today, it's very, very difficult, I guess. But yeah, and it's something that connects more than anything. And point three would be a connect. If we can build personal direct connects with our audiences, with anybody we are interacting with, you know, friends go out of their way to help you. And so, for me, that's been the three mantras. I stick by it. And if, like, you put a gun to my head right now, these are the three things I would recommend.
Wonderful. Switching gears, Nakul, let's talk about design and user experience. And one of the things that I have always, you know, proposed and I'm a big fan of is this notion of aha moments. And this is especially true for consumer products, whether it's digital or even phygital these days, right? Where as soon as you get involved with the product, your first experience is a wow, right? And a lot has been said about it. A lot has been written about it. And, you know, when you were doing your performance the other day, I couldn't but, you know, think about connecting the two. So can you talk a little bit about, you know, principles of magic that you applied in digital design and this notion of generating awe and wow and ahas?
Service magic comes to mind, Amit. The Disney's book on service magic essentially talks exactly what you said about giving that unexpected wow. And with regard to design, that's what holds true. Interestingly, a lot of the top designers have dabbled in magic. or whether you go to Bruce Tognazzini or even Edward Tufter, you see a lot of them having some connect to magic, and you see that coming through the whole info design world that has now morphed into user experience. Well, somebody like Amazon comes to mind when you say user experience with magic, because they are working not just on getting you what you know you want, but also trying to get you things that you still don't know you want. One of the patents of Amazon comes to mind, which is called predictive delivery, which actually maps and tries to find out which user would like to buy something if it was available to them in a very short notice. I'm not sure if this is already implemented, but I read about this somewhere. And the element was that if they can get a product closest to me because they know I am one of those people who will buy it, then they will get it into a nearby warehouse and keep it there, which essentially means that it would pop out to me when I log in saying, hey, you may be interested in this product and this is on Prime and it can reach you in the next 4 hours or whatever that is. And and the other thing that comes to mind is Disney itself. Disney's these wearable tags that completely customize and personalize an experience within the Disney world. I have not yet been there, but what I hear and read is that every experience a person goes through is customized to a great extent based on these tags that they are wearing. And people don't know this. And so they get experiences which they like, but they don't know they like, because Disney knows that based on the various things they've already done within the park, either that day or in past experiences. So yes, a bit of this whole mind reading thing, I guess, is what we are all aiming for. Can I know what my user wants even before my user knows? And can I then deliver it to that user without them having to click and tell me something and fill a form and all that stuff? Can we go predictive in terms of the entire user experience?
So Nakul, when you are designing something for a client, like in terms of the user experience part of it, how do you do the mind reading part or the customer discovery? Are there some lessons that you've learned from there? Because unlike an audience where you are putting on a show, where you have something in mind, you know a little bit about the audience, here you're helping somebody design an app for, you know, service delivery, right? Now it's very different. So can you talk a little bit about your customer discovery process?
I have been embedded in the whole design thinking side of things for a number of years. As you know, I worked at SAP from 2005 to 10, and right through I was embedded into this whole design thinking philosophy, before which it was put yourself in the user's shoes. So I have had firsthand experience, and that's been my foray in terms of design, of actually doing full cycle design and interviewing people, observing them, running a lot of formative and usability testing for top companies from around the world. And is what really fascinates me, because that's where I really see a connect between what I do on stage and what I do within a lab setup, or even when I'm visiting a customer site to just observe and see how a warehouse works. When they are trying to say, oh, this everything happens on the SAP system, but then you see a lot of these small little post-its or long printouts on their desk, and you try to figure out what is that there for, and you realize that a lot of work actually happens on those pieces of paper and not in the system. And then you try to come back and figure out how can we make it completely back into the system, which means there is a lot of things that the user really wants, which is not included in that design. And so that is one of the things. And so how does my kind of skill sets help? Because one of the things I have worked on, and again, these books will help you, is observation. We have, over the years, trained ourselves not to look, right? Let me try something with all of our audiences right now that are listening. I want you to just cover your watch. If you're wearing a watch on your hand right now, I want you to cover it. And I want you to, in your mind, think of the number 6 on your watch. Now, watches are special, right? Each of us has a watch which sort of called out to us, was gifted to us. And so when you now think in your mind, this watch that you've had, your favorite watch, if you have a lot of them, what is number 6 on your watch? Because number 6 is very special, you know, it's like the insignia of a company. For some, it is in fact the insignia of a company. For some, it's just a dot. For some, it's a line. For some, it is the number 6. Now, that could be a bold or italic. It could be gold. It could be silver. Just in your mind, I want you to try and lock on to what number 6 in your watch looks like. Do that now. And when you have locked it, I want you to look at your watch and I want you to see how close or far away from that 6 you wear. And remember, this is a watch you've worn for such a long time and this is a watch you look at so many times in a day. Well, if you're wearing an Apple Watch, perhaps I should have said that, can you remember the watch face that you have? But you know, this small little thing, it changed my life. I read it in a book called How to Develop a Superhuman Memory by Harry Lorraine, about 25 more years back. And it basically told me that we have trained ourselves not to look. We have trained ourselves to only see the things that we want to see, which explains how we drive through home to office in a regular non-corona world and do not look at any of the billboards that are on our way. When we look at a newspaper, we do not see 90% of the ads or the articles that are there. And so, oh, by the way, the reason I came up with this for you right now was not just that number 6. You just looked at your watch, but without looking back at your watch, can you tell me the time? And that is the moment that happened to me, Amit. That is what shocked me, that I just looked at my watch, I'd looked at number 6, but I'd not observed or caught on to the time. You know, our mind looks at everything. It's not like it is shutting down. But it is, in fact, that whole thing of the mind having been trained or our brain having been trained not to remember things. So that's one of the first things we should do, unlearn and learn how to observe. And I think that will solve a lot of these problems that we are talking about.
So Nakul, Danny Kahneman, who has this absolutely epic book, Thinking Fast and Slow, one of the cognitive biases he talks about in that book is what you see is all there is. So you do decisions based on what you see. And what you just illustrated with the watch example is perhaps that we're not even seeing enough, right? We're sort of in this microscopic tunnel vision of whatever else we are distracted by and hence probably making poor decisions.
Amit, I will complicate that slightly further for you. This whole aspect that Kahneman talks about has been also talked in a lot of other books. And of course, he's the god of it right now. The thing is, let's go to this example of you going and meeting somebody for the first time, right? You walk in and this person is walking up to you and you now shake hands with this person and say, hi, I'm Amit. And so we put in all this for the competitive among us, I guess the CSR knowledge of, you know, shake hands and give him a tight shake hand and a firm shake hand and all that. Oh, of course, pre-corona world, now it's a namaste. But the aspect of it is, at what point do you think this point of observation started? Was it the point when you walked up and said hi? Was it the point when you shook hands? At what point do you think that happened?
I would suspect even before, as soon as you show up in their, you know, radial vision, like in their 360 vision, right? Just saying, oh, who's this walking up? And what is my sense about them?
Exactly, Amit. But like I said, I was going to complicate it for you. That 360 degree vision you're talking, or 180 degree vision in that sense, is absolutely right. But it's not when I know I have perceived them. It is when the mind has perceived them. And the mind keeps doing a lot of unconscious things. And the mind does one thing which is very, very, very sad, which is good from a human perspective, is it categorizes. So the moment you're even walking into an airport and you have hundreds of people walking out, your mind is looking at all these hundreds, categorizing them into these small boxes of stereotypes that are in your mind. And this you do not yet know. And so when I have now walked up to you, your mind recognizes me as one of those stereotypes that it had pre-assigned me and has already slotted me into a like or a dislike category. And that is where the complication really starts, because you don't know how your mind has categorized this person. All you know is whether you'll suddenly feel a liking or a dislike to this person. And if we know this, then we can use that information to be a slightly both from the perceiver and the person meeting. We can perhaps use it to our advantage and give this person a second chance.
Absolutely. Very, very fascinating and a lovely, mysterious, wondrous note to perhaps wrap up on. We could go on for hours. But Nakul, thank you so much for being on the Prime Venture Partners podcast. Lots of interesting insight, lots of book recommendations. We'll get some of those offline from you and add it to the show notes. Thanks again, Nakul, for joining us on the show.
Amit, thank you so much. It was a pleasure. I talk too much, as you know, but I hope this was all useful. And thank you so much.
Dear listeners, thank you for listening to this episode of the podcast. Subscribe now on your favorite podcast app for free, and you'll be the first one to know when new episodes are available. Just search for Prime Venture Partners Podcast in Apple Podcast, Spotify, Castbox, or however you get your podcasts. Then hit subscribe. And if you have enjoyed the show, we would be really grateful if you leave us a review on Apple Podcast. To read the full transcript, find the link in the show notes.